Yes, it's the extras for Daniel. So Daniel is my favourite book of the Old Testament, and we have in the Apocrypha three editions, the Prayer of Azariah and the Song of the Three Jews.
And perhaps the two most interesting ones are, I think, Susanna and Bel and the Dragon.
I'll talk about Bel and the Dragon.
So Bel and the Dragon is immediately exciting because you think, wow, a dragon in the Bible? And it's true, there is a story about a dragon within the deuterocanonical books. Bel and the Dragon, in a sense, is really three stories. A story about Bel, B-E-L, who is an idol, a Babylonian idol. A story about a dragon, so it's not like St. George and the Dragon, it's not Bel fighting a dragon. The dragon is a separate part of the story. And then thirdly, the third part of Bel and the Dragon is actually a description of Daniel in the lion's den, which we also hear about in Daniel 6 within the book that we're perhaps more familiar with in the Protestant canon.
This is one of the additions to the book of Daniel. It's there to show that Daniel is a sage full of wisdom. And the book takes the form of three riddles. The first riddle is about Bel himself, this great idol. Every night, according to King Nebuchadnezzar, who has set him up, he eats huge quantities of sheep.
The proof that Bel actually is a real god is that every day the priests bring food into the temple, they close the doors, and then in the morning, the food's gone because Bel has consumed it.
So Daniel comes along and Daniel says, no, Bel cannot be a god. There is only one god, which is exactly what we read in the first six chapters of the book of Daniel. He says, there is only one god. Bel is a fraud.
And Daniel sets out to solve the riddle. He does this by shutting all the doors around the temple where the idol is, but sprinkling ashes on the ground.
And it turns out that the priests of Bel have been going through a secret entrance and eating the food themselves.
The next morning they come, all the food has disappeared, all the dead sheep, all gone.
And the king says, aha, we got you, Daniel.
No, says Daniel, the first ever detective in history. Look at the footprints in the ash. In fact, it was the priests and their wives and children who came and ate.
And so the king is enraged and these priests are punished. And Daniel is honoured. Once again, it's this theme of reversal going on.
Yeah, it's kind of a mix of Sherlock Holmes or Poirot or something. He does some good work there, because it seems that he's in a really difficult position, but he proves through the use of ash that Bel is not a god.
Then we get the story of the dragon. The dragon, I find this, the story of the dragon kind of bizarre.
Just like Bel, the dragon is seen to be an idol by the Babylonians. It's not clear what the dragon is, what kind of creature it is, but it's a real thing this time. Bel is just some statue. The dragon is a living creature, but they see it as a god.
This is a real god whom the king worships. You can't destroy my god, says Nebuchadnezzar to Daniel. Yes, I can, says Daniel. I can do it without a sword or a cudgel. Second riddle.
Then Daniel took pitch, fat and hair, and boiled them together and made cakes, which he fed to the dragon. The dragon ate them and burst open. Then Daniel said, see what you have been worshipping.
And by this point, having got rid of two of their idols, the Babylonians are getting pretty cross with Daniel. And actually that leads then into the third and final part of Bel and the Dragon, which is Daniel being thrown into the lion's den. So despite the king's protests, he decides, because of what Daniel's done to the Babylonian people, Daniel must be thrown into the lion's den.
Now, this isn't the riddle of how he survives the lions, which is the story in the main book of Daniel. It's how he exists for a week without food.
We hear a bit more about this lion's den, that there are seven lions. And also another interesting aspect of the story that we hear in Bel and the Dragon, quite exciting, is that Daniel is fed from one of the prophet Habakkuk, when he's in the lion's den. So what happens is Habakkuk is making a stew, I think. He's making a stew and he's got some bread. And the angel of the Lord comes to him and he says, go and feed Daniel. And Habakkuk says, because he's in Judea, well, I've never even been to Babylonia. How can I go and feed Daniel?
He's lifted by the hair, by the angel, carted across to Babylon. And there he gives the pottage to Daniel, who survives.
So whether the third part, the description of Daniel in the lion's den, is actually complementary to chapter 6 of Daniel, so describing the same things from a different perspective, or whether it's another case of Daniel being thrown in a lion's den, which would be pretty unlucky, twice in one lifetime, it's not clear. The story of Susanna is quite an interesting little one, very short, and obviously the key figure here is Susanna.
These prurient elders who each admit their desire for Susanna to the other sort of hide in order to catch her unawares as she bathes and sleep with her. And then, of course, they blackmail her. If you don't sleep with us, we'll say you were having sex with a young man.
So Susanna, she's described in the book as an upright woman. Her faith in God is intact. He's a very friendly little guy. So Susanna's been given this conundrum: either sleep with these dirty old men, basically, or be exposed as having an affair with some fictitious young man. But she's faithful to God, and she says, "No, I won't sleep with you. You'll have to sort of expose me as an adulterer or whatever."
Because they're elders, the people who are charging her, they are believed. She's taken to court, and the people believe them that, yep, she's deserving of. She needs to be punished for this, and so they decide to take her off to execute her.
She can be viewed as an anti-feminist heroine because it was so popular in the Renaissance period to have pictures of Susanna naked, bathing, looked at by elders, the woman the object of the male gaze. But on the other hand, she kind of stands up to this and she wins thanks to Daniel, who comes along.
Now, this is where Daniel comes in, because at the trial of Susanna, which is obviously a fait accompli because the judges are the guys who have been blackmailing her, at the trial of Susanna, Daniel steps forward. This is where he comes in the book, and he's prompted by the Spirit of the Lord, it says, and he says, "Stop, this isn't fair. We need to cross-examine the elders."
"Where was she when she was having this sex?" "Under a mastic tree," says one. "Under an evergreen oak," says the other.
So this shows that they've made up the evidence, basically, that they've been lying. So instead of Susanna being put to death, the old men, the elders, the judges, they're shamed and they're put to death.
Obviously, Susanna is rather a kind of passive character throughout the courtroom scene. There's not much that she does there. But she is brave in the beginning, and so as far as I'm concerned, she's somebody who wins out against the prurient male gaze. Again, like many books in the deuterocanonical apocryphal group, it is about wisdom. Daniel acts here like King Solomon. Solomon, if you remember the story of the two women who each claimed it was their baby, threatens to cut the baby in two, and this reveals the truth. The idea is that you can find truth in this world, and it can be revealed, and you must trust in God that the truth will out.
But in this story, it wasn't God that saved the day, it was just Daniel being clever.
It's always human beings in all these stories. Sometimes there are angels, sometimes there are divine agents. But very often, it's the idea that truth, that God is immanent, God is actually within historical processes, within creation. And therefore, human beings can be his agents. A very high view of the human.